third of the brain mass is actually glial cells. So the majority of them don't actually have currents going across them. So all in all, what we're going to have to do is make the differentiation between fundamental research and clinical application. If we're going to go for fundamental research, then yes, we are going to have to go for the more realistic models.
Yes, I agree with that concerning the tools you can involve for fundamental research. I mean, you can really get some absolute realistic model, except for the conductivity. I'm more a bit less confident in this field because we don't know very much and we don't know how to get the data in this context. And if you go to really realistic models, then maybe that this conductivity is may influence compared with all the details you put in it. The conductivity may become an important issue also. But of course, this kind of realistic approach may help in putting some confidence intervals in resolution limits on more simple models that can be used for clinical purposes, for instance.
I mean, most of what you said concerns EEG measurements. Have you done or are you planning to do anything for
EEG? As I said, we are more involved in EEG recording, so that's why we emphasize the EEG evaluation, but we are thinking about doing it perhaps for EEG.
Do you have any feeling as to how these results might be modified for EEG, where you're more selective in your spatial sensitivity? For example, you might not have to worry very much about the lower part of the head, because the EEG measurements are more selective in the spatial dimension.
Yes, of course. This could be, you can make more simplification on this part of the head. This has to be checked.
Okay, and now I move to the final contribution for this afternoon. Maria Helen Giart from INSERN on scalp current density mapping.
So I would like to show what what scalp current density analysis can say in the attempt to understand the relationship between the ERP waveforms, the neural process, and the cognitive process. But before coming to this point, I would like to precise something about what we call scalp current density compared to current source density, which is almost the same words but not the same significance. The current source density methods primarily tend to estimate the primary current in the brain, whereas the scalp current density distribution shows the distribution of conduction current on the scalp and not in the brain. That is, to estimate the current source density, you need a model and for the geometry of the head and the different conductivities of the different layers in the brain, skull, scalp. You need no model for scalp current density mapping, except assume that there is a constant scalp conductivity. The scalp current density have very specific, very interesting properties compared to the distribution of potential. First, they show map independent of the site of the reference electrode. Second, their distribution are less smeared in the scalp than the potential map. That is, they allow to dissociate components which can overlap in potential maps. And third property, very interesting in using them, is that they are more sensitive to shallow generators, that is to cortical generators, than to deep generators inside the brain. So now come back to our problem. So if we are interested in the relationship between ERP, the neural process, and the cognitive process, we meet two problems. The first problem is related to the neurophysiological mechanisms that underlie NLP components. This is directly related to the knowledge of the neural generators active, neural generators of a component. And the second question is related to what internal information processing operation is manifested by a surface ERP component. This is a very hard question, very often impossible, even almost impossible to answer when we are interested in long latency ERPs and in cognitive process. But any attempt to try to answer this question is determined not only by the empirical data, but also by the theoretical framework that is a psychophysiological model within which the data must be are interpreted. The first slide, please. So, recently, Natanen has developed, has proposed a model for the role of attention and automaticity in the processing of auditory information. And this model is based primarily on the neurophysiological mechanisms that underlie three ERP components, the N1, the mismatch negativity, and the processing negativity. The N1 component of the auditory potential is elicited by any kind of discrete stimulus, and most of the studies of a lot of different areas have localized its main generators in the supratemporal plane of the auditory cortex and in the auditory cortex as well. Especially the MEG recordings have localized dipole in the supratemporal plane of the cortex. Yes, all three components here are generated in the auditory cortex. All three involve these areas. The mismatch negativity is at least, functionally also, the N1, according to Natanen, the N1 would be related to no more aspect of perception than simple detection that something has happened, nothing else. It would act, in fact, as an onset detector which can trigger the attention of the subject that something has happened somewhere. The mismatch negativity is elicited by any kind of change in a sequence of homogeneous standard stimuli. And the MEG also has localized its generator in the supratemporal plane of the cortex. And functionally, according to Natanen, it is also related to, it would reflect an automatic pre-perceptual comparison process between a sensory inflow coming from a deviant stimulus and a memory trace of the standard stimuli. And in fact, this memory trace will form the electrophysiological basis for the memory, sensory memory, which is called echoic memory. And functionally, its biological function would be to alert the individual that something has changed in the environment of the subject, and just to be, it would be a kind of call from the pre-attentive process to the focal attention. Not really an attention shift by itself, but a call to the attentional mechanism. And what I want to show is that these two components show, in fact, scalpel density of these two components show activities in frontal areas in addition to activities in the auditory cortex. And if we interpret this data in the model of Natanen, it is probably the frontal components which are better candidate to be related to some attentional process than component in the sensory areas. Also, I will say something about the processing negativity, which is related to selective attention, not automatic attention, but selective, voluntarily maintained attention. And which are also some frontal activities, but very different from the two others. Next slide. So here is an example of N1, very classical N1. In red, right here, and in green or black, I don't remember, left here. Usually, people say that there is three peaks, three components in the N1, called N1A at 75 milliseconds, N1B at 100 milliseconds, and N1C at around 130 milliseconds. And Scherg's model have localized two dipoles in each hemisphere, one tangential in the supratemporal plane and one more radially oriented in the temporal region. Next slide. So here is the distribution of potential between 65 milliseconds and 135 milliseconds to a right ear stimulus. And what can be seen is that there is a frontocentral negativity, which is more on the frontocentral areas here, with a positive potential in yellow. Green is positive, in red is negative. Positivity at the level of the mastoid, which is the reference is at the nose. And that is in accordance with what has been described by Vaughan and Ritter about generators in the supratemporal plane with a zero here around the Sylvian fissure. Next slide. That is the distribution of scalp current densities of the same response in the same time window. That is, it's quite corresponding to the previous maps. And what can be seen is that the scalp current density separates the vertex potential in two sync and source, and sync in red and source positive in yellow, two sync source pattern, one in each hemisphere, very separated from the vertex potential we could see in the last maps, with zero line current, zero along a line much more precise than in the previous maps. What can be seen also that is that it's right here stimulation. We can see that the temporal currents are more intense over the left hemisphere than over the right hemisphere, much more visible than in the potential maps. That is quite in accordance with the dipole, if it speaks in terms of dipole, with dipole in the supratemporal plane of the auditory cortex. And when we arrive around 120 milliseconds, the things here are much more intense than in the previous map, suggesting that some additional generators, more radially oriented, are superimposed to the temporal one or replace them, as described by the models of Scherg. But what is new is this frontal current here that appear during all this time window and which are very stable, in fact, during all this time course of the N1, and which emerge about at the same time as the temporal current. Next slide. Another way to see the same thing, top view, left hemisphere view, right hemisphere view for right ear stimulation. We can very well see that is potential maps and that are current density maps. We can see very clearly this frontal component quite well separated from the temporal current. And that has not been described by the MEG studies for several reasons, either because there has never been squids on frontal areas, that is possible, or because the tangential, the dipole is more radially oriented and can be picked up by MEG system. Yes, also what we can say about this current is that given the properties of the current to be sensitive to shallow generators, it is probable that these currents come from cortical areas and not from deep structures because they are very well shown on the scalp. In fact, this result raises two comments. First, the observation of two sets of generators active during the N1 means that probably parallel processes occur in response to an auditory stimulus. And a second point is that these results could account, at least in part, for the apparently conflicting conclusions about the generators of the N1 when in the data recorded from lesion patients who have lesions either from the frontal areas or temporal areas, and we still show some N1-like component as described by Knight. Next slide, please. Oh, the same thing for the left ear, and we can see that over the right hemisphere, the current are more intense than over the left hemisphere for the left ear, so that is contralateral. But always the frontal component very well shown here. Next slide. So that is now the mismatch negativity, which is in fact recorded between, in red are the response to the frequent stimuli, and in green are the response to the rare stimuli. And in purple is the difference between the response to frequent and the response to rare stimuli. And it is in this curve that we study the mismatch negativity. We see that this is the highest amplitude are in frontocentral areas. Next slide. Here is a distribution in potential, scalp potential distribution of the mismatch negativity in 8 different experimental conditions, varying the ear of stimulation, the direction of attention, and the pitch of the tones. And what we can see is that in the 8 situation, the mismatch negativity is asymmetric on the scalp and involves mainly the right hemisphere. Irrespective of the ear of stimulation, the pitch of the tones, and the direction of attention. Now the next slide. That is always the potential distribution of potential of the mismatch to the right ear stimulation. As we have seen just before, right hemisphere predominance in potential with a positive potential mastoid, always in accordance with the results of MEG and dipole models, which has shown that its origin comes from the supratemporal plane. But now, if you look at the scalp current density distribution corresponding to this map, we can see that there are, again, a sink source in each hemisphere with a zero line along the Sylvian fissure. And these temporal currents here are stronger over the left hemiscalp for right ear stimulation. In fact, and for the left ear stimulation, it would be the inverse. It is the inverse. It is temporal currents are stronger over the right hemiscalp than over the left hemiscalp. And there is also a frontal current here, which is more intense over the right hemiscalp. And in fact, it seems probably that what gives the potential the highest values of potential over the right hemisphere in all the situations we have seen before is in fact the sum, is due to the sum of activities of two sets of generators, one set in temporal areas, more intense in the contralateral hemisphere, and one set in frontal areas, more intense over the right hemiscalp here. The sum of activity of all that giving the potential, highest potential of the right hemiscalp. What is interesting is that these results do not fundamentally question the model of Natanen. Natanen had said that the mismatch negativity was due to an automatic comparison process at the sensory level. In fact, if we hypothesize that the frontal component here could be related to this attentional mechanism, automatic attentional mechanism, caused by the detection of a change at the sensory level, then our results can bring further elements for the models in dissociating functional processes on the basis of activation of distinct brain areas. And we could propose this once the sensory specific memory system has experienced a change at the sensory level reflected by the temporal mismatch component generators, then a frontal process related to attentional orienting occur, which would be reflected by this frontal current here. Also, now our data do not allow us to extrapolate to the clinical domain. We may keep in mind, in fact, the patients who suffer of who suffer impairment, hemineglect impairment, that is, these patients, in fact, have problems in automatic attentional of automatic automatic switch of attention to a stimulus. We know now that is something which is automatic, not controlled, which happens in this kind of hemineglect patients. And we also know that this impairment, that this syndrome is much more severe and frequent in right hemisphere lesion patients than in the left. And it would be interesting to know if our frontal component here that we relate to attentional orienting could be related also to the severity observed in these right lesion patients. Next slide, please. Very shortly about the selective attention now. That is a very usual paradigm for selective attention. We ask a subject to attend the stimuli in one ear and to ignore all the stimuli in the other ear. And in a subsequent series, we ask him to attend on the other side and to ignore the sound in the first ear. And if we compare the response to the attended stimuli, to the attended stimuli compared to the same physical stimuli when they are ignored, then we can have the effect of selective attention. In red are the curves, the response to the stimuli, attended stimuli, in green to the ignored stimuli, to the same one. And in purple are the difference between them, that is the effect of selective attention. This wave has been very widely studied by many authors, by Hilliard's group, Natanen's group, and many others. And most of the authors now recognize that there are at least two components, at least, because there are probably much more, but one or several in sensory-specific areas, and a later one, frontal. I just want to speak about the frontal component, the later one. Next slide. So that is the distribution of the difference wave, that is the effect of attention, the processing negativity as called by Natanen, between 150 milliseconds here up to 315 milliseconds in potential. The two first lines are potential. What can be seen is that with increasing latencies, the potential shift towards the frontal areas. You can see it here, negative red. Very frontal areas in potential. Here are the corresponding scalp current density maps, and what can be seen is that there is nothing in frontal areas at the latencies where there was a strong negativity in frontal areas. Instead, the potential, the current stay rather more centrally distributed. That would mean, given the properties of SCDs to be sensitive to shallow generators and blind to deep generators, it means that the generators responsible for this distribution of potentials here are probably probably from deep structures of the brain and not from shallow layer of the cortex. It is possible that there is something here which stay in cortical areas, but this current here cannot be responsible for this distribution of potential here. So there must be probably deep structures active in control of attention, selective attention. This does not mean that there is no activation of frontal cortex in selective attention, but what we pick up by this this experiment comes from deep structures. So these studies, in fact, show that in the three processes, which are related in a different way to some attentional mechanism, automatic or selective or voluntarily maintain attention, each time the frontal cortex is involved, but with probably different generators, and these generators probably reflect different functional processes.